we just relay some facts,
whether they're new or antique.
So just sit back and relax.
It's time for What's Up This Week.
Hi everyone, and welcome to What's Up This Week, your weekly dose of facts and trivia from University Branch Library. This week marks the anniversary of when President Polk asked the United States Congress to declare war against Mexico on May 11, 1846. 2 days later, Congress made it official. The war that ensued stemmed from multiple disputes. One of them had to do with Texas. Good old Tejas. For many years, Mexico had control of the area. However, its citizens revolted against their government and established the Republic of Texas in 1836. Yet, Mexico refused to acknowledge Texas's independence. Eventually, Texas was turned into a U.S. state, a development which the Mexicans didn't like so much. There was also the matter of the border, the boundary between Texas and Mexico, that is. Mexico claimed this state never went farther than the Nueces River. Also, Mexico owed the U.S. a financial debt to compensate for the lives and property lost in Mexico during Mexico's war with Spain earlier that century. So the Mexican-American War commenced. There were many major figures involved. On Mexico's side, there was General Antonio López de Santa Anna and Juan Seguin. On the U.S.'s side, there was General Zachary Taylor and General Winfield Scott. The war consisted of dozens upon dozens of battles and sieges happening across 1846, 1847, and into 1848. The war concluded in February 1848 with the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo. The chief component of this agreement involved Mexico giving a considerable amount of land to the states. In return, the U.S. paid Mexico $15 million. The territory included what are now California, Nevada, Utah, and parts of Arizona, New Mexico, Colorado, and Wyoming. In the wake of the Mexican-American War, the United States added over 500,000 square miles. This, of course, was a substantial acquisition for the U.S. in helping it to become the massive nation we know today. This enormous and deadly war, like those that preceded and succeeded it, was complicated and filled with a diverse group of humans with various hopes and intentions and details this segment doesn't begin to cover. So to learn much more about this event, check out any of these library books. Okay, Kim, what do you have for the people this week?
Hello! This week we're celebrating the birth of the surrealist artist Salvador Dalí. Dalí was born on May 11, 1904, in Figueres, Spain. He is best known for his highly technical skills and strange symbolic surrealist paintings. Dalí was introduced to modern art, futurism, and cubism early in his arts education, influenced by artists like Picasso. In the 1920s, he began gravitating towards surrealism. He fell in love with the Prado Museum in Madrid, visiting it every Sunday morning to immerse himself in the art there. Dalí's talents were obvious by the time he completed his 1926 painting, The Basket of Bread, and he left the San Fernando Royal Academy of Fine Arts before graduation. He dove deeper into the surrealist art world. Dreamlike images and unusual symbolism became staples of his works. He became known on the art scene as an eccentric man in both appearance and mannerisms. He once stated to a lecture audience that, "The only difference between me and a madman is that I am not mad." In 1931, Dalí painted The Persistence of Memory, which is one of his most well-known works. It questions our perspectives and ideas about time and space with its melting clocks, a theme that appears in more than one work of Dalí's. Dalí created artistic works consistently throughout the World War II era and beyond. In the 1950s and 60s, he took an interest in religion, science, and math, and experimented with different artistic techniques like bulletism, pointillism, optical illusions, and holography. In fact, He was one of the first people to use holography in art, influencing the likes of Andy Warhol, among others. During the Spanish Civil War, a museum in Dali's hometown of Figueres was burned down. In 1960, it was decided to rebuild the museum, and Dali designed the entire thing. It holds the largest collection of works by Dali, including some of his sculptures, 3D collages, mechanical devices, and more. In the final years of his life, Dali lived in an annex to the Dali Theater Museum, and upon his death in 1989, he was entombed in a crypt below the stage of the old theater. Dali left a huge mark on the art world, and not just with his paintings. He also explored sculpting, filmmaking, theater, fashion, architecture, writing, jewelry making, and graphic arts. He rubbed elbows with the likes of Picasso, Coco Chanel, Freud, Hitchcock, Disney, and other notable figures from pop culture. To learn more about Dali's fascinating life and works, or about the Surrealism movement, you can check out any of these library materials. All right, Megan, what weird thing do you have for us this week?
Hi, everyone. This week's weird thing is that May 13th is International Hummus Day. On this day, we celebrate hummus, the delicious and nutritious dip that hails from the Middle East. Hummus is a dip or spread made out of garbanzo beans, also known as chickpeas, tahini, which is a sesame seed paste, lemon juice, and garlic. This is the most basic hummus recipe, but it's common to garnish the hummus for extra flavor. Hummus is super healthy, packed full of vitamins, protein, iron, and more. It can lower your cholesterol and reduce your blood sugar. It's traditionally eaten with pita bread and can be an appetizer or a snack. The Western world has come up with all sorts of interesting variations to the traditional hummus recipe. Nobody knows the exact origin of hummus, but many parts of the Middle East will claim it as theirs. The so-called hummus wars have been going on for many, many years, especially between Lebanon and Israel. Hummus has been around for centuries, which is why it's so hard to pinpoint where it comes from. The earliest known recipes can be found in cookbooks dating back to the 13th century. Hummus didn't become popular in America until somewhat recently, in the last decade or so. We may have been late to the hummus party, but hummus is now a staple in many American households. To celebrate International Hummus Day, you can eat hummus for breakfast, lunch, or dinner. Bonus points if you make it yourself. If you've never eaten hummus before, this would be the perfect day to give it a try. And to all the hummus aficionados out there, this is the day you should try a new recipe or flavor. We've got cookbooks with a variety of recipes to make your very own homemade hummus. We've also got a documentary about hummus called Hummus, the Movie, which you can stream via Hoopla. Happy International Hummus Day, y'all. Be sure to join us again next week for more facts and trivia from University Branch Library.